Dear Thomas, I now understand why you declined my hand in marriage. It was immature of me to demand that you stop your life pursuits just to watch time pass by with a dumb country boy like me. I have returned home to Ravenshollow, and in this time I have grown stronger in ways I'd never thought myself possible. I have my own life path now, and while it breaks my heart to know I will never see you again, I think you would be proud of my newfound purpose. You are my last connection to this world, and I wanted to give you one final goodbye. Farewell, Thomas. You are the one beautiful thing I ever found in this cruel world, and I wish I could drown in those blue eyes just one last time. Love always, William. P.S. Don't come looking for me.
Who dares interrupt our service to God? What do you want, outsider? I'm afraid you've come to our town during a time of cleansing. The last souls with blood untainted by the fruit stand before you. He isn't on the pile of smoldering corpses, if that's what you mean. You could try his house. It's located on the opposite side of the valley. That is, if you can even make it that far. There is a billboard by the main gate that will show you the way. If you get lost, simply remember that the windmill faces the town, and the rear faces the Forester property. Outsider, before you leave, take this rifle. It belonged to Abraham Walters, and as you can see, he is no longer in need of it. Well, once you get outside the church, be sure to take the time to put at least one bullet in the chamber. That way, if things get dire, you can at least shoot yourself. Be careful, outsider. Beyond that gate is a land rife with sin. May the Lord have mercy on your soul.
From the beginning. your lancer.
So, Thank you.
gone. So. So. Gone. Gone. Ra. Kun. Gone. In. Coup. Ra. Gone. Zo. Thank you. Ku. Ra. Zo. Gon. In.
Where am I? Why is it so cold? My chest. I can't breathe. Thomas? Is that really you? It really is you. I would recognize those blue eyes anywhere. I'm sorry, Thomas. I really wanted to tell you. But saying you were joining an ancient race of forest fays, not something big so easily put in the letter. Wait, how can you understand the words I am saying? I lost the ability to speak English some time ago. No, no, no. Thomas, you should not have. This knowledge is forbidden to mortals. Even French.
I'm dying, Thomas. The words you recited are wrong. Only mortal this small amount of time. Look at you. Saving me yet again. But I need fresh, untainted blood. Alas, but under the darkness. No, I need much more. This tree seems to have drank it. Now
you've done well to lead us here. Now step aside and let us finish this. What you have found is not William. Look around you. Look at the soil. Look at the trees. Look at my people. This land has become infected, a seething rot that only fire can cleanse. All you need to do is walk away. I don't want any more bloodshed. Please, outsider. You can walk away, it's not too late.
Thomas strolled through the carnage he had wrought, blood seeping through the mud and leaves, forming a web of crimson. In the center of the gore, he found Sister Pyrus. She lay on her back, gasping in short, sharp breaths. Malice filled her eyes as Thomas came into view. She tried to mouth something, instead yielding to a bout of wet coughing. Thomas gazed skyward to the rolling storm clouds. He gripped his axe tightly until his knuckles glowed white. He felt his eyes begin to well with tears, but caught himself in the final moments, drawing a deep breath, and with it, new resolve. He wrenched the nun by the ankle and began dragging her back to the den, while she wheezed and spluttered in protest. My William, my love, my eternal star, I will never, lose you again.
You've done well to lead us here.
Thomas stumbled clear of the den, letting his rifle fall to the ground. He had seen enough. Sister Pyrrhus delivered a solemn nod as he passed her in the mud. She and the others encircled the gnarled old tree and put it to the torch. Moments later, the thing burned intensely, the crackle of old wood submitting to the flame. The church fell to their knees, offering up a prayer in unison. A single long scream pierced the night, guttural, yet unmistakable in identity. Thomas felt sick. That thing, that is not my William, he whimpered to himself. The next day, Thomas returned to the city. Consumed by memories of what transpired, he soon turned to the bottle. Several months later, he stumbled drunk through a back alley and was attacked by a thief. Unwilling to part with William's engagement ring, he was soon shot through the heart for his troubles.